Thank you very much. Good morning or afternoon, everybody. Yes, so in this talk, I would like to show you our recent results and ideas about how to make spintronic neural networks with radio frequency communications. So as you know, the goal of neuromorphic computing, let me just... So the goal of neuromorphic computing is to implement low-power artificial intelligence chip. The reason for that is that AI today has made incredible progress, but it's consuming too much energy, so it's an environmental problem. And also, this energy consumption actually slows down the computation. So it really makes sense to try to take inspiration from the organization of the brain to reduce the power of AI chips, because the brain actually consumes orders of magnitude less energy than a supercomputer. And this is done to the fact that in the brain, memory and computing are completely entangled. And so we are seeking to put together a lot of artificial neurons and synapses. And for this, there are many challenges that I'm going to discuss before showing our ideas to solve them. So the first challenge is the number. In the brain, you have 10 to the 11 neurons and 10 to the 15 synapses. So this shows that a neural network has heavily parameterized models, let's say, where synapses are parameters, and neurons are doing the computing. This means that if we want to build powerful chips, we need to put a lot of these devices, artificial neurons and artificial synapses inside. And this means that we need nano devices. And so the first challenge is to develop nano devices that reproduce essential features of neurons and of synapses for neuromorphic control. Sorry? Can you hear me? Yeah. So the first challenge is to reproduce essential features of synapses and neurons with nanoscale devices. So we don't know exactly how the brain is working yet. So we don't know what is. We can't reproduce everything also, and so. Let's say that a good way to figure out what are the minimal features that we should imitate is to have a look at the current models of neural networks which are working well. And these neural networks are called deep neural networks. And so I illustrate here the main functionalities. So they take the information is encoded into real values. And this information propagates through the network. And so at the output of neurons, you have these real values, and then they are multiplied by coefficients, which are called synaptic weights. And these are then summed and sent to a neuron. And the neuron, in fact, is a nonlinear mathematical function. This here shows what are the essential features that we need to reproduce. For the neuron, you see, we need some nonlinearity, basically. So we mean that we need to be able to emulate this kind of behavior. So here I show one of the neural activation functions that is most used today. It's a rectified linear unit. And the second thing very important is to be able to implement this multiply and accumulate operation that I show here. And then you see that the synaptic weights here are in fact some kind of analog valves for memory, with memory. And so it's very important at the same time as we do this multiply and accumulate operations that the devices that implement synapses actually memorize the synaptic weight that is going to be tuned for learning. So yes, we need to do that. And the second challenge is that we need to build deep networks. So the power of artificial intelligence today comes from the ability to build networks with a large number of neural layers. And why this is essential is because the deeper the network, the more you are going to be able to extract some meaningful features from your input and more abstract. So here you see, this is an example where you have an image at the input of the neural network, and you see that the first layers are going to extract some contours, shapes, and then when you go deeper in the network, it's going to specialize to some features like eye, mouth, nose. And then at the end of the network, the neural network would be able to identify faces. Okay, so the depth is very important. And so it means from a point of view of hardware that we need to be able to efficiently implement these successive multiply and accumulate operations. So we want to have MAC operation, non-linearity of neural network, MAC operation, non-linearity of neurons. So we need to find efficient ways to implement this hierarchical structure. It is very important. And the third challenge is that we need to densely interconnect these layers of synapse and neuron. So today, in deep neural network, because of the limitations of GPUs on which they are running, there are about 100 synapses per neuron, something like that. But in the cortex, you have 10 to the 4 synapses per neuron. This is what you see here. This image is a 3D reconstruction of a retina. And each wire, each color is a wire that connects neurons together. And you see that the way the brain achieves this high density is by this crazy connectivity in 3D with very complex wires. Without 2D electronics, it would be very difficult to do that. So we need to find ways to implement neural network with this high density using new electronics or new physics. And so our idea in my group is to try to see if we could, instead of using just wires to connect synapses and neurons, try to complement electronic direct wire connectivity by radio frequency communication. Because after all, we know that radio frequency communication is a very good way to interconnect a large number of units. And for example, people with a smartphone, right? But we need to do that at the nanoscale. And this is where spintronics comes to play an interesting role. Because as you know, magnetic tunnel junctions and all spintronics actually can exploit the dynamical degree of freedom of magnetization. And this dynamics occurs at the gigahertz, so typically in the radio frequency domain. And so, as you know, when you take a magnetic tunnel junction, when you inject a DC current through spin torque, you can excite sustained precession of the magnetization. And if you record the voltage across the magnetic tunnel junction, you are going to be able to measure, this is a measurement here, to measure these microwave oscillations. Okay, so this is the radio frequency property, emission property of a magnetic tunnel junction, so called spin torque nano oscillator. And what is interesting here is that the more current you put, when you change the current, you are going to modify the spin transfer torque on the magnetization. And so you are going to change the frequency. And you are also going to change the emitted power of the junction. And so here is a measurement where you see that the microwave power at the beginning is zero because you are below the threshold of excitation by transfer torque. But above a given current, above the threshold current, you see that the emitted power, which is basically the voltage squared, is increasing. And you see here that we obtain something that really looks like the... Sorry, is there a question?
So, no, it's okay.
Okay.
Sometimes there is some noise from the people which come in.
Okay, thank you. So, yes, you see that here the emitted power as a function of the DC current really looks like the rectified linear unit of neurons in artificial neural networks. And so it means that we could use the current as the input information to the neuron, use the nonlinearity here, the output, to imitate neurons and then broadcast the result through the created microwaves. Okay, so here we have the possibility to create an artificial nanoneuron. So in our case here, the experiments are performed with devices that have a vortex configuration and a diameter of about 400 nanometers. So the DC current is of milliamps. But if we reduce the size, we can really go to much smaller current. So we expect we can function in the microwave, okay? And to keep it low power. So what we did is that we wanted to show that magnetic tunnel junctions could be used as neurons. And the best way to do it is to actually demonstrate a neuromorphic task. Because you know that nano devices are always noisy, they can drift because of the small volume. And I mean, a neuron is a processing unit in the neural network, so it needs to be stable enough to perform the operation. And so at the beginning, we started with just one junction, so we needed to find a way to perform neuromorphic computing with a single magnetic tunnel junction. And so for that, we use the trick that is called time multiplexing, in which a single junction is going to imitate all the neurons in a neural network, one after the other. And in order to compute, we used a framework of neural networks that is called reservoir computing that has the ability to exploit also the rich dynamics of these oscillators. And so the task we perform is spoken digit recognition. So some people are recorded. They pronounce digits from 0 to 9. We take these waveforms, we accelerate, we pre-process them through a random process. Then they are sent to the oscillator and we collect the signal that is generated, and then the synaptic part was done on a computer. Okay, and what is important is that what we have shown is that the nano oscillator was able to recognize the spoken digits with a success rate above 99.6%. And this is important because actually this is as good as software. So it was proving, what it proves is only that these oscillators are good enough, stable enough to be used as neurons. Okay. But then of course we needed to go beyond that. So we wanted to prove that we could build neural networks with microwave communication between the layers. So what we did is the following. We built a two-layer neural network. So the first layer is composed of microwave equipment. So we have two microwave sources that generate two microwave signals with two frequencies. Okay, one frequency for each microwave source. So this is lab equipment. And we encode vowels in the frequency of these sources. And these sources, they send their signal on a strip line above four nano oscillators, four magnetic tunnel junctions that constitute the second layer of the neural network. Okay? And so you see that here the information propagates through microwaves. The microwaves are guided above the oscillators, and because the microwave signal generates a magnetic field above the oscillators, the dynamics is modified, and it is by studying how the oscillators synchronize to these microwave inputs that we have been able to show that we could train the oscillator to recognize the vowels sent by the microwave sources. Okay, and so this result demonstrated the ability of a neural network to communicate through microwaves. Here, however, you see that the microwaves, they were sent directly to the strip line above the oscillator. So it means there is a communication, okay? So it means that it's like a synapse. However, it is fixed. You cannot tune this link between the two layers. To achieve very important task and complex task, now we need to have synapses, because it is the synaptic plasticity of neural networks that allows them to learn and to perform complex problems. So the question that we have is, that we had, is how can we connect layers of spintronic oscillators as neurons with elements that would perform this multiply and accumulate operation efficiently on the microwave signal generated by the spintronic oscillator. And we have recently showed our, posted our concept on archive here. So the idea is very simple, actually. We said, well, we can just use for the synapses magnetic tunnel junctions once again, but this time we are going to use them in a different mode, not as oscillators, but as resonators. So the idea is to use this magnetic tunnel junction in the spin diode mode. So you know that when, so if you don't put any DC signal through the magnetic tunnel junction and you send a microwave current through the junction, this microwave current through spin torque is going to excite the magnetization. And if the frequency of the incoming microwave current is close to the frequency, to the resonant frequency of the magnetization, you can excite large angle precession through spin torque. And because you have large variations of the resistance multiplied by the microwave current, so you have two oscillating entities that oscillate at the same frequency that are multiplied, then you generate a DC signal. And here, this is an experiment. You see this spin diode signal. So this is the DC voltage recorded across the junction as a function of the frequency of the microwave input signal. Okay. You see it has this special shape here. It does not exactly look like a resonance. Here, this is because the field light torque is responsible mostly for our signal, and we get this shape. And what is important here is that the signal increases with the microwave power. Okay, you see the different colors are due to different input microwave powers. So it means that the output voltage, if I'm at a given frequency, is increases linearly, in fact, with the microwave power. So you see that the junction here used as a resonator is multiplying the microwave power with a parameter that we call here the synaptic weight. Okay, so it's going to be used as a synapse. So let me explain a bit more. So these are now simulations. So this is again the voltage across the junction as a function of the input microwave frequency. Okay, when we, if for example, I am here, so here you have the resonant frequency of the junction and I send a signal at this frequency, an input signal at this frequency, and I increase the power, you see, I get different VDC across the junction. And here, if I plot V as a function of the microwave power, you see I have a linear variation. And because the slope is positive, it corresponds to positive synaptic weight. And now, okay, if I'm going to change, imagine I'm able to control the microwave, the resonant frequency of the junction. So it can be done by an external magnetic field or by modulating the anisotropy of the junction through some non-volatile way. Then, if I'm able to change this resonance frequency, and I'm doing the same thing, you see here that now the slope, the dependence of the voltage on the input power is negative. So this is a negative weight, all right? And if I can control continuously the resonance frequency of the junction, I can control the weight precisely. So this is our idea for doing synapse. So how can we perform the multiply and accumulate operation? Well, the idea is to use frequency multiplexing. So we are going to put different junction as synapses here in series. So we call this a chain of synapses. And we are going to change the size of the junction or the thickness, the geometry, the material of the junction to have different frequencies here. So each junction is going to be in charge of filtering a given, given frequency band. So the synapses are, you see, respond only in a frequency band. Each synapse, it's some kind of filter. And we are going to send the input microwave signals also at different frequencies, corresponding to the frequency bands managed by each junction, so that this synapse will only speak to this neuron here, to this input signal, this synapse to this one, because their frequency are close. Okay, and you see that if we do that, and we send through a chain like this the sum of all these microwave signals, naturally the voltages across each, the spin diode voltage across each synapse are going to sum, and so we are going to obtain a weighted sum of the input microwave powers by the weight defined by the resonant frequency of each junction. So this here, this arrangement is going to emulate this neural network, okay, this single layer neural network. So we did that experimentally on two junctions here. So what we do is that now we have two magnetic tunnel junctions in series, and we control their resonant frequency with the DC current that we send through strip lines that are above the junctions. And you see here the experimental voltage, where you have two of these spin diode signals. And by changing the currents above each junction, we can control. You see, for example, this is for this junction, we can tune the weight. And for this one, we can also tune continuously the synaptic weight. And so when we send two microwave signals through the junctions, we can perform the multiply and accumulate operation of the two input microwave signals. And here, I'm not going into detail, but here this is the experimental voltage as a function of the ideal MAC operation, and you see that we have a very good match. Okay, so it proves the feasibility of the approach at a very small scale. Now, of course, to go further, we want to have not just one output, but we want to put different synaptic chains. You see that because we have this frequency multiplexing, we can have a very nice way to implement multi-output neural networks. You just need to add more synaptic chains, and you naturally do this kind of operation. What is nice here is that you see that, for example, for having 8 synapses, we need only, instead of having 8 wires here, we need only 2 wires. So it's a simplification, and this frequency multiplexing allows, is more flexible for connecting the synapse we want with the neuron we want, so on and so forth. So we have done some simulations to see how well this was performing on a larger scale. So we took a benchmark database of handwritten digits, that is called DIGIT, and we took a model of spin diodes that includes device imperfections such as their nonlinearity. Each pixel is converted into a microwave power and sent to chains of junctions. So here we have 64 synapses because we have 64 pixels, and we have 10 chains because there are 10 outputs, because there are 10 digits from 0 to 9. Okay. Here you see all the spin diode response of the 64 junctions. And so we have trained this network with backpropagation, and we show that we achieve a success rate, equivalent to a software with this simulation. So this is a very good indication that this kind of system can learn despite device nonlinearity. So to conclude, our goal here is really now to design and build a deep neural network made of these spintronic nanosynapses and nanoneurons with radio frequency interconnection. So we want to make this kind of system. So we are working towards this goal. So of course, it means also that we need to go beyond the lab equipment operation and also develop chips. And so this work is very exciting because you see that it combines physics, algorithm, and electronics. And so in the first step, we want to also to train these neural networks using backpropagation. So you see that in that case, we use the RF connection. We use a radio frequency signal and dynamics of the junctions only as a way to generate microwave and connect the element. But in the future, we also want to use the intrinsic dynamics of all these elements as a way to enhance the computing capabilities of this novel type of AI hardware. Thank you. And so if you are a student and if you are interested, don't hesitate to contact us and send the CV, because we are hiring now to do that. Thanks.